It is 10:05, and the site selection business meeting of the 73rd World Science Fiction Convention will be in order. We'll go through the front matter, and then we'll get to the site selection announcement. I am the presiding officer, Kevin Standley. To my right is Jared Dashoff, the deputy. At the far end is Donald Eastlake, the parliamentarian. To my left is Linda Dinneroff, the secretary. Our timekeeper is Jesse Pershing. The sergeant at arms is Joyce Reynolds Ward. She has a staff of people keeping the meeting moving along, doing the people mover stuff. And the videographer in the back of the room is Lisa Hayes. She and her staff have been working on keeping the videos up and running. The chair observes that the videos from the first 2 days' meetings are all online on the YouTube events channel, Worldcon events channel. There have been, in some cases, more than 300 views of some of the segments. I would like to once again thank I would like to also thank DEPCON 1 for their grant toward some of the cost of the additional technical equipment necessary to get those videos online as fast as we could. And I would like to remind people that because of the limitations of the recording equipment, we will have short technical timeouts approximately every 30 minutes. I would like to remind people that these technical timeouts of 1 to 2 minutes, they are short. They may be less than 2 minutes. If you get up and start moving around, the meeting may reconvene around you. Let's see, number four. Once again, you do need to come to the microphone. You need to check off your name on the attendance list. And you need to silence any sound-making devices, such as your cell phones. And if you get a telephone call, you need to quickly move out of the room to answer it, at Ms. Dinneroff. Site selection agenda, please. And if, like me, you tweeted out some things that got a lot of retweets, really, really silence your phone. You really don't want to hear bing, 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 bing all meeting long. This is the site selection business meeting. The special order of business at this meeting is the presentation of the site selection results for 2017. This will be followed by question time for next year's Worldcon MidAmericon 2. That is a guaranteed item in the standing rules. It's not constitutional, it's a standing rule. And there are time for presentations for the 2018 bidders. There will be no presentations for any other bidders. Did the 2018 San Jose bid rep ever show up? I did not see him.
They were up pretty late.
Yeah. I want to try and deal with this before we get to site selection business if we can. Having spoken with the bidders have, as far as I can tell, their representatives here have agreed to dispense with their presentations at this meeting if there is no objection for them doing so. Is there any objection? There being no objection, presentations from the 2018 bidders are dispensed with. Those are privileges of those bids, and they can dispense with them at their discretion. Question time is guaranteed by the rule and requires the suspension of the rules. MidAmericon 2 has agreed to suspend the rules and dispense with question time for the 2016 Worldcon. Is there any objection to doing so?
Yes.
Is there a second to their motion that I got before the meeting to dispense with question time for 2016? Two-thirds vote being necessary to suspend the rules and dispense with their question time. All of those in favor of dispensing with question time for the 2016 bid, raise your hands. Hands down, those opposed? There being two-thirds in the affirmative, question time for the 2016 Worldcon is dispensed with. The 2017 site selection election results will be announced in just a moment. However, the chair, trying to be very blatant and obvious in his sponsorships, given that he is a director of the Montreal Worldcon bid and of the San Jose in 2018 Worldcon bid, is unable to preside over these things. The deputy chair is an officer of one of the 2017 Worldcon bids, and he also is unable to preside, and therefore we both are recusing ourselves in favor of the parliamentarian.
The timekeeper was on committee, but you need me, so I'm staying.
Okay. Right. So, the chair will recognize the head of the site selection administration to report.
Good morning. I am Joni Brill Dashoff, the site selection administrator. This is Judy Bemis, my deputy. The two of us have been treasurers of Worldcons and understand the importance of a proper handoff. I will start, sort of knowing in advance that the two people who have recused themselves would have any parliamentary questions I had actually ended up with Don Eastlake in advance to start with. Except for one thing, I was not here for any other business meetings. The Constitution says mail. It doesn't specify postal versus electronic, maybe because there didn't need to be a reason to do that. So this year, knowing that three of the bidders were from outside the U.S., I specifically went through parliamentarian and div heads all the way up to the chair to ensure that I had everyone's concurrence to allow electronic delivery of ballots. It was not restricted to outside the U.S., and it was not used solely by outside the U.S., nor was the Postal Service delivery used only by U.S. citizens. The envelopes with the foreign stamps, I deprived Todd of that, are in the handoff material. No, I did not do a summary. I'm just giving you a report that this is up to snuff, and the only question was electronic signature, which was taken as a separate issue. Period. All right, I'm going to read from the least number of votes up to the highest.
Should I let Don put story?
Yes, you can read along with my shoulder. Over my shoulder, because I'm not sure how good my voice is. Boston in 89 received one vote. Marseille, France received one. Maryham received one. Happiness Fulfillment Corporation received one. I'm going to abuse this. Gnevoy, Armenia received one. Gallifrey, Chiron received one. Minneapolis in 73 received two. Night Vale received three. All of the above, thank you, Mike Scott, for putting them in consecutive time order for that to be a possibility. There was much discussion about how the filing would go, whether the individual filings counted as a filing for all of the above. It never actually came other than the write-in count of five. Invalid sits at one, but that was only the one submitted as valid by payment, which was an X, a one, a two, and a three. There were others that were invalid by duplicate payment for site selection on one membership. There were many that were members of Worldcon, this one, that did not pay the voting fee despite being told them there was, but that there was an additional fee that was basically the membership for the 75th Worldcon. About half of them paid money to have their votes included, and the other half didn't. There were other people who paid the 75th Worldcon fee, but I have no record that they were ever members of Sasquan. Unfortunately, those, because they paid to be 75th Worldcon members, are in the hands of the actual 75th Worldcon, so I do not have a count of that. I just wanted you to know there were more categories that counted as invalid. And there were people who failed to sign their ballot, which forced them to be no preference. Most of those I caught in advance. The last weekend before the mail. Voting was 225 by email delivery, and the mailbox in Huntington Valley was stuffed to the gills and cleared out every 2 days for the last 2 weeks. So somewhere in that time, and between those, that was about half the voting by mail in advance. So I apologize to anyone who's I was unable to get to give me a better signature to be counted. No, I'm not. I'm up to none of the above actually got zero. People took this seriously. Nippon, for 2017, registered 120 votes. Montreal, in 2017, received a total of 228 votes. Washington, D.C., in 17, received a total of 818 votes. Todd, sorry, I crossed my sevens. and Helsinki in 2017 received a total of 1,363 valid votes. Ah, yes. This is Patrick Malloy's counting thing. So, program, sorry. The first thing he figured out is out of the total number of ballots cast, with preference being 2,606, that in order to win, one needed 1,304, therefore 1,363 was the clear winner on the first ballot. There was no need for redistribution. I would like to thank everyone for bidding and giving us a choice. This was definitely a vigorous decision based on the number of people who submitted ballots, whether counted in the end or not. I would also like to thank my staff, and congratulations to Helsinki, Finland. Are there any other questions to me as administrator?
Right. Is there any other questions or motions?
A motion to accept.
Right. I would like to a motion to thank the tellers and accepting the results and order the ballots destroyed. Okay. Is there any objection? Is there any objection? Hearing none. The tellers are thanked. The results accepted, and the ballots are ordered destroyed. The selection of the 2017 winner is final.
Thank you. Thank you.
I believe the chair was going to be resumed by Mr. Stantley, or is that? Or we? He seems to have forgotten this. I could keep running the meeting if you want. I don't know.
Yes, once the results were official, the bias goes away. Mr. Dashoff may rejoin us at his discretion. I'm aware of that. The members are asked to remember that the chairman is one of the people who helped write many of the rules and is generally aware of many of them. Thank you. Before calling upon the winning 2017 Worldcon bid, the chair would like to recognize Mr. Glenn Glazer of Sasquan. Yes, would the representatives of the winning Worldcon bid please come up to the head as well, please? Where are you? Yeah, Emily? Yes, thank you. A moment, please. Have you spoken yet, Emily? Have you spoken today? Or the transcription might want to know how your name is spelled.
Hi, I'm Emily.
Two E's.
E-E-M-E-L-I. Congratulations.
Earlier in this business meeting, the other day, we received a piece of long-awaited good news in that Millfield closed its books. They asked us to keep in trust for them the half of their remaining funds, which they chose to disperse. Half went to next year to Mid-American, too. And the other half, as I said, was given to us in trust to give to whoever won. That I am doing now. It is now my privilege, and I mean that, to present to you a check for $23,000 to the Helsinki Worldcon.
In a technical sense, we are now reached question time for the 2017 Worldcon, which means we have up to, I believe, 10 minutes. Now I'm misremembering.
Five minutes of presentation.
Yeah, so 5 minutes of presentation and then questions thereafter. We'll see how that goes. Okay. The chair recognizes Emily Aro.
Hello. Cool. Hi.
Hi.
I don't need to be a bitch here anymore. There is no more Helsinki in 2017. There is Worldcon 75. And instead of me, you get to have three other people in charge of it. So, could I have, please? Jukka Halme. Saija Aro. And Crystal Huff. And to just make sure it's entirely unintentional that together they make up team Ha to make a follow-up to next year's team LOL. And now, since my work here is done, I pass on the mic.
Give them the check, Emily.
Stop it, man.
Give them back their check.
Give
them back their check, Emily.
Stop that man before he starts another bid. Okay. Hello. My name is Jukka. I'll be one of the co-chairs of the Worldcon 75, which will be held in Helsinki, Finland, from 9th to 13th of August 2017, in a lovely exhibition center we have there called Messukeskus. You will learn a few Finnish words along the way. And Saija, would you like to say something?
Help. No.
Oh, hello.
Oh, hello. I'm Saija, and thank you.
Hello, my name is Crystal Huff, and I am very excited to be here as well. And I think we are going to pass the mic for a couple of announcements. We are incredibly excited to announce, for those of you with smartphones, that our website is www.worldcon.fi, as you can see. There are very exciting pieces of information on this website.
If that's going to keep dropping out, you can take this.
Pardon us for our technical difficulties, including our guests of honor. And we would love to share this information with you. So, we are incredibly excited to announce that one of our guests of honor is John Henry Holmberg. He is a Swedish fan. He has edited fanzines and is a fantastic human being.
So next we have Nalo Hopkinson.
Yay! Yay! She's a great author.
And then we have Johanna Sinisalo, a proper Finnish science fiction author, who writes science fiction and fantasy, the winner of the prestigious Finlandia Award. Jon Henrik Holmberg, by the way, has won the Big Heart Award, so he's no stranger to these things. And who's this Claire Wendling?
Claire Wendling is a French artist of comics and movies, I believe. And she is also a fantastic human being.
And then we have Walter John Williams. Yay!
Who is quintessentially the Finnish science fiction author, since all his four grandparents were born in Finland. Hello, Walter. Okay, what next? Oh, so in case you would like to come to Finland, we will open our registration at noon at the location where the site selection was held. And we will have rather reasonable prizes, which are available via our progress report zero, which has been handed over, and on our website, worldcon.fi.
And for those of you, and there are many, and we are so appreciative, who friended or subscribed to the bid and voted, you have an automatic attending membership to our convention. Thank you so much. If I may for a moment, everyone in the audience, can you raise your hand if you have worked on a Worldcon or worked on a Worldcon bid? Raise your hand. I would like to thank all of you because we do this all together. We create this convention together and we have all worked to come to this point. We very much appreciate the teams from Washington, D.C., and Nippon, and Montreal. They are our friends, and we hope that we will create a Worldcon that you all feel like is your Worldcon, and that you will join us.
In the interest of time, I would like to ask that we dispense with question time for this Worldcon. I believe all the questions you may have of them can be easily and more productively dealt with at their Worldcon table that they will be opening a little bit later today. Is there any objection?
There, no.
I heard, the chair reminds people that the way you say that you have no objection is to keep your mouth shut. Is there any objection? Hearing none, that is dispensed with. The chair, let me see, it's 10:28. In order to, because I believe there is a bit of turnover and we do need a technical timeout at this point, a chair would like to ask how many people were in planning to leave at the end of this site selection information. Hand, show of hands, please. In that case, this meeting is adjourned for approximately 2 minutes. Recessed for approximately 2 minutes. The meeting will return to order at 10:31. Looking ahead to the rest of the agenda, we will pick up with what we did not, where we left off at the previous meeting. It is our intention to adjourn today's meeting by noon, not 11:45, but by noon, for the Worldcon Chair's photo session, which will take place on this stage. There's an additional factor in that because of the program schedule and the fact that the back half of the room is programming today, the air wall is scheduled to go back up at 12:30. We have a very limited amount of time, about 10 to 15 minutes to rearrange this stage. Are you trying to interrupt me for something? Well, there are seats in the front of the room, but if people want to sit back there, that's their prerogative if they want to sit in the back of the room. Sorry, getting back to what I was trying to talk about, please. The air wall is going to go back up at 12:30. We have very little time to reset this room, and we will need to do so rather quickly and turn it back into a program room before 1 o'clock. The sergeant at arms are advised of this, and we're going to need help from you folks to move these tables back, move these chairs out of the way, make space for the Worldcon chairs photo session, the video of which will be shot from the back of the room, and then take it all back apart again. So I appreciate your assistance in doing so, and as we adjourn close to noon today. All right, so now we are at constitutional amendments where we left off. And now we're back on the agenda at our popular ratification. Item A1 failed, and I have the wrong number up there. It was 69 to 99.
I fixed it.
Yeah. Oh, thank you. I have it on my copy. Thank you. Item A2, A Story by Any Other Name, which is on page 7 of the agenda. Move to amend Article 3 of the WSFS Constitution to clarify that the eligibility for the fiction categories should be based on content rather than the format of delivery. Is there any objection to ratifying this amendment? Mr. Illingworth, please come to the microphone. State the question.
Is the listing of categories in section 3.2.5 correct? Tim Illingworth.
Mr. Illingworth, you've got to speak directly into the mic. And your name.
Tim Illingworth. In the second amendments to section 3.2.5, are the story categories 3.1 through 3.3.5, or are they 3.1 through 3.3.4 and 3.3.6?
No, I see what he's saying. Hang on. One, two, it was actually meant to be 1, 2, 3, 4, I thought. Just a moment.
3.3.6 is graphic story.
Why? Just a moment.
So it currently just says 3.3.1, 2.3.3.4.
Yes, excuse me. Pardon us here. We've forgotten about this one.
I don't have an opinion.
I think it makes more sense to be 3.3.6 because old graphic works. Well, later works don't necessarily have a clear author as such. I mean, it's.
Hang on just a second here. I'm consulting with the maker of the original motion.
Everyone turn to the person next to you and say, "Good morning, I'm glad you're here." Shh, it's hard to hear, please.
No, it's okay. The maker of the motion has clarified that the intent of the second clause was to consider novel, novella, novelette, short story, and graphic story. That was the intent.
Okay.
And therefore, we believe that the numbering in the second clause is meant to be 3.3.1 through 3.3.4 and 3.3.6. Does anyone object to this? Can we correct that now? Okay, there is an objection. Okay, then the exact wording as in there will take us only through best novel through best related work and will not include graphic story. I believe, just a moment.
I think this was my mistake because I recall making this correction somewhere, but it didn't make it into the agenda and I don't know why.
We need to resolve this before we can ratify it. Okay. The chair's ruling is that it is meant based on what the maker of the motion tells us was meant to be, is that it was meant to be best novel, best novella, best novelette, best short story. That is 331 through 334, and 336 best graphic story. That's the chair's ruling. Is the member rising to appeal the ruling of the chair? Sit down, Dennis. Mr. Olson, come to the microphone. What's that?
It says story, and 335 is not necessarily a story.
All right, yeah, that is in fact what's in the program book. I'm sorry, folks. Well, we're looking at the piece up here. The program book, which has the version on the website, and the version on Loncon's website, and in your souvenir book on page 143, actually reads 331 through 334 and 336.
Not the one on Loncon.
What? The chair rules that the version in the printed piece of paper you all got when you registered is definitive. Mr. Yellow. Oh, I hope you're not planning to appeal this. Mr. Yellow, you will speak to the audience and stop turning your head to look over here because we can't hear you when you do it.
Ben Yellow, I am appealing the ruling of the chair because I believe it is important to get into the record the minutes as produced by Loncon's secretary say explicitly that what was passed was 3-3. Was 1 through 5. We need to get a definitive ruling as to how these conflicts are dealt with, and therefore I wish to appeal the ruling of the chair, which will force
Ben,
these
it was
results
a type
into
of
the minutes.
You're arguing the substance.
Which will put the results into the minutes so that we have a ruling going forward.
Is there a second to Mr. Yellow's appeal? Second. All right. Very well. This is an appeal. 5 minutes.
Can I speak?
Yes, you can, but not yet.
Okay, tell me why.
I would like to remind the members how an appeal is dealt with. On an appeal, the chairman gets to speak first on why he ruled the way he did. Then people can speak against the ruling of the chair, then in favor, and then against. And the chair gets to speak last, and therefore I would reserve 30 seconds at the end of my end of the time.
You don't have 5 minutes, by the way.
Yes.
There's not 5 minutes left.
The chair asks unanimous consent for up to 5 minutes to debate this. I don't think we'll need it. Hearing none, 5 minutes. The chair's ruling is that while the minutes are produced by the head table staff, the definitive document of business passed on is itself certified by the head table, by the chairman and secretary of the business meeting. And it is that document that is the document upon which we depend. That is the ruling of the chair, is the document certified by the chair and secretary as the business passed on, even if it varies from the minutes of the meeting as issued by those same people. Very well. Speech against the ruling of the chair, Mr. Yellow.
Given the importance of that particular decision...
Mr. Yellow, stand straight, speak into the microphone, and stop trying to look over at me.
Given the importance of that particular decision, I think that it is vital that as many people as possible should vote on this issue so that we can get a definitive ruling into our future rules.
A speech in favor of the ruling... Ms. Dinneroff, I want to recognize her. She's been asking, and she's an interested party.
Okay. It was a typographical error. It was my mistake. I apologize, but I think we're going a little bit overboard about it.
Speech against the ruling of the chair. I'm trying other people. A question of privilege. Will the member will please come to the microphone and state his question of privilege?
Best related work.
And it is section 3.3.5 of the Constitution is best related work. And this is outside the scope of it's outside the scope of the debate because the appeal is on what version of the passed on business matters.
I think the question is relevant.
Okay. What's that? The member's question was, what is section 3.3.5? The chair. What's that? The chair was actually recognizing Dr. Lurie. You can't not actually call the question unless you've been recognized by the chair. Dr. Lurie speaking against the ruling of the chair.
Yes. The text that is underlined there, 3.2.6, makes no reference whatsoever to graphic story. If it is the intent that this include graphic story, that needs to be added to the changed section 3.2.6.
The chair reminds people the debate need not be factual, and I'm not editorializing.
The short title says, by inserting a new section after existing 3.2.5, which is 3.2.6, and enumerates the categories best novel, novella, novelette, and short story. It makes no reference to the graphic stories.
Mr. Eastlake.
Okay, what I want to say is that I don't think the ruling of the chair is actually necessary in some sense, that if you look at the text here, it says in the story categories, and 3.3.5 isn't a story category, and 3.3.6 is a story category, so it's inconsistent. Therefore, there must be an error, a typographical error of some sort, and the resolution in favor of the business passed on is seems like the right way to do it.
Yes. Is there a second to end the debate? Moving to end the debate. Don't even let me get my closing argument in, darn you. All right. Those in favor, how many people still wish to speak to the question of the appeal? Raise your hands. Is there any objection to ending the debate? The question is on sustaining the ruling of the chair. The ruling of the chair is that the version of the amendment printed in the program book as certified by the head table staff of last year is definitive and takes precedence over any printed minutes or other documentation. All those in favor of sustaining the ruling of the chair, raise your hands. Hands down. Those opposed to the ruling of the chair, raise your hands. Hands down. There being less than a majority in the negative, the ruling of the chair is sustained. The version in the program book is definitive. I would like to once again read the actual proposal, which is printed on page 143 of your program book. Let me sit down here. On page 143, the actual proposal, move to amend Article 3 of the WSFS Constitution to clarify the eligibility for the fiction category, to clarify that eligibility for the fiction categories should be based on content rather than the format of delivery by amending as follows. It consists of two clauses. The first clause is to insert a new section after existing section 3.2.5. And then it adds a new section, 3.2.6. The categories of best novel, novella, novelette, and short story shall be open to works in which the text is the primary form of communication, regardless of the publication medium, including, but not limited to, physical print, audiobook, and ebook. The second clause is, and amending section 3.2.5 to read, section 3.2.5, in the story categories, parentheses, 3.3.1 through 3.3.4 and 3.3.6, close paren, an author may withdraw a version of a work from consideration if the author feels that the version is not representative of what the author wrote. We have thoroughly used up any possible debate time there was on this in appeals. Is there a motion to extend debate? An amendment would be in order, but although there is no debate time left.
There is debate time left.
You used it all up in the appeal. Didn't you use all 6 minutes up? Or how much was left?
Well,
I'm sorry, how much was left after subtracting the time we spent on the appeal?
There's 157 seconds left, but the way you made the motion, it was 5 minutes. It was 5 minutes for debate on the appeal.
Yes,
there was still debate time remaining in the main motion. There just wasn't that full 5 minutes.
Okay. There's 150 seconds total remaining. If you subtract the five after subtracting the debate we just had on the appeal, how much time is left?
Okay.
Is there any objection to setting a debate time to raising the debate time back to 6 minutes total? No. The debate time is now reset to 6 minutes total.
Okay.
We're just starting over.
Sounds good.
Okay. Dr. Lurie.
I move to amend section 3.2.6 by adding the words graphic story between novelette and and.
Wait. It has been moved and seconded to amend the section, the ratification of section 3.2.6 by inserting, well, actually changing the first portion of the sentence to read, the categories of best novel, novella, novelette, short story, and graphic story shall be open, etc. And it has been seconded. Is the member's parliamentary inquiry about whether it makes it a lesser change or not? Or is it, yes? Yes, I knew you all were going to, so I just was trying to. Several members were about to move to ask whether it was a lesser change or not. The chair is in doubt on whether it is a lesser change and submits the question to the members. All those who believe that it is, let me try it this way. All of those who believe it is a lesser change and therefore could be ratified today, raise your hands. Hands down. All of those who you believe it is a greater change and would require additional year, hands down. The chair believes that the greater change has the majority. If this amendment is adopted, it makes it a greater change. This motion would therefore require an additional year of ratification. The chair recognizes Dr. Lurie to speak in favor of her amendment.
Since we just said that the story category should include graphic story, it only makes sense to me that we should be consistent within the two parts of this proposed constitutional amendment.
Mr. Dashoff, who will therefore be recused from the remainder of the debate on this subject.
Jared Dashoff. I believe, and I will yield to the makers of the original motion, but the two clauses are separate in their purpose, and therefore we need not add graphic story to the second clause.
To the first clause, I think you meant, actually. To the first clause. Speech in favor of the amendment?
Motion to amend by substitution.
No, you can only do that when the first order, you can only do amendments at this point if the first order amendment was for substitution. You cannot amend the amendment. Okay. A speech in favor. Thank you. Thank you.
Family drama.
Mr. Todd Dashoff.
Todd Dashoff, I believe that when Mr. Stanley read the motion, the word fiction was prominent in the beginning of the motion. I think that automatically includes graphic story.
A speech against the amendment. I'm sorry, I, because the lectern is over here, I'm going to miss people over that side, so you might have to get more of my attention.
Colin Harris, I was the maker of the motion.
Colin, hold the microphone to your mouth.
Colin Harris, I was the maker of the motion with Mary Robinette Kowal last year. It's sort of unfortunate that in carrying this forward, the commentaries that were with it last year aren't repeated, and they do clarify this. We made two changes. One was to the four fiction categories. What we did was we introduced the word story, where we used to have written fiction, because in the past, people tended to use written fiction as, oh, that's not audiobook then. So even though it wasn't explicit in the Constitution, there was an implicit interpretation. We wanted a more neutral wording. So we made the main change in 326 to say the four classic fiction categories should be open to work in which the text is the primary form of the communication. I'd say graphic story is not something, by definition, in which text is the primary form of communication. We then changed 325. Nothing about audiobooks, but we wanted to remove the words written fiction just because, again, they were conveying that cue and get more neutral wording. So that's why we have the two clauses. And in fact, it was explicit in the commentary last year that it said 325 will extend the clause to cover best graphic story to avoid the word written, which carries that weight. And as I say, in response to the amendment, I would say text is not the primary form of communication in graphic story as it is not in BDP. And these were the categories we're trying to separate in introducing the idea of audiobook as legitimate. Thank you.
That was a speech against the amendment, speech in favor. You don't have to speak if you don't want to. There's been a motion for the previous question to close debate. Is there a second? How many other people will still wish to speak to the question on the amendment to the proposal only? Okay, all those in favor of the amendment from Dr. Lurie to add graphic story to the first clause of the amendment, raise your hands. All those in favor of adding graphic story, raise your hands. Hands down. Those opposed? Hands down. The negative has it. The amendment fails. We are back to the version printed in page 143 of the program book. How much total debate time remains on the motion?
Each side has about a minute and a half.
About a minute and a half left. Ms. Secor, is there an objection to closing the debate? I'm sorry. How many people still want to debate? Hearing none, is there any objection to ending the debate? The debate is ended. On the motion to ratify item A2, a story by any other name. All those in favor of ratifying the constitutional amendment, raise your hands. Hands down. Those opposed? Hands down. The affirmative has it. The constitutional amendment is ratified. It takes effect at the end of this Worldcon. How are we doing on time? Okay, thank you. Item A3 is Hugo finalist. Move to amend portions of Article 3 of the WSFS Constitution to change references to these works or people that appear on the final Hugo Award ballot to finalist and to change references to candidate to nominee as shown in the redlining. It's on pages 143 through 44 of your program book. Is there any objection to ratifying this constitutional amendment? Hearing none, this constitutional amendment is ratified and takes effect at the end of this Worldcon. The secretary is now catching up. When the secretary is ready. Well, you know, we were optimists when we made the slides initially. And I was doing that slide that you're seeing that you're making fun of my typos at about 12:30 this morning. So cut me some slack, eh? Maybe in the back of my jacket. Sorry, sidebar. Well, if you insist, I don't like, okay, never mind.
Okay, I'm ready.
All right. Item A.4, WSFS membership types and rates. Moved to amend the WSFS Constitution by inserting a new section between sections 1.5.7 and 1.5.8. The new section would read, no convention committee shall sell a membership that includes any WSFS voting rights for less than the cost of the supporting membership required by Article 4 in the section, in the selection of that convention. There's 4 minutes debate time on this. Is there anyone who wishes to debate it just by a show of hands, please? Nobody? Okay. Is there any objection to ratifying it? By unanimous consent, the A.4 is ratified.
Thank you for making my job easy.
As we are moving now to new constitutional amendments, the chair is going to have another technical timeout, but is there the member rising for a question? Would the member come to the microphone, state your name, speak directly into the microphone, and face the audience rather than the head table? And then state the question.
I would like to ask...
Speak your name. Say your name.
My name is Jeff Thorpe, and I would like to ask the chair... if the motion that we have passed has any effect on the ruling of the chair in 1990, when a member aged 11 was allowed to propose a motion to this meeting.
Ah, very well. I'll understand this. There is a ruling made in the past that a member aged 11 made a motion before this meeting. That wasn't you, was it?
No, I got the dates wrong.
Sorry.
The circumstances was a motion which was seconded by Donald E. Eastlake IV.
It was him. Okay, sorry. In 1990, an 11-year-old member of the convention holding an attending membership to the convention, am I right? Or was he?
Yes, he was a full attending member
of the convention.
He was a full attending member.
He was a full attending member, just like most of you in this room. And he participated in the conversation. A point of order was raised that he was underage. The chair ruled that it was legal for him to participate. That is in the rulings of continuing effect. The inquiry was, does the just passed rule about membership types and rates have any effect on that ruling? The chair says, no, it has absolutely no bearing on that. None whatsoever under any circumstance. Is that clear? Thank you. Now, I want to elaborate slightly before we have a short recess, but WorldCon has an attending membership and two discounted membership rates for military and young adult members. Those two classes are just attending memberships by a different name. They also have a child membership, which does not have voting rights. If someone has a child membership that doesn't have voting rights, they're not a member of this assembly. But they could be 1 day old if they have an attending membership, they're a member of this organization. There is no age restriction on WSFS memberships. Thank you. Honestly, I believe some of you have forgotten what it was like to be young. This meeting is in recess.
Yes, we have.
I believe perhaps it would be best to take the bio break at this point. This meeting is in recess until 11:10. It is 11:10, and the meeting will return to order. The chair has been requested by the interpreters to slow down just a little bit between taking the affirmative and negative votes to allow them to keep caught up. And the chair apologizes to the interpreters for running on so fast. The next item on page 10 of the printed agenda is the 5% solution. Item B12. Moved to amend the WSFS Constitution to eliminate the requirement that finalists must appear on at least 5% of ballots in a category by striking out words as follows. It would strike out all of section 3.8.5. and sections of 3.11.4. The chair recognizes, the debate time on this is 6 minutes. Yes, 6 minutes. The chair recognizes, if he's here, the maker of the motion, Mr. Garib.
I'm also
Mr. Is it Desjardins. The chair recognizes Mr. Desjardins.
My name is Stephen Desjardins. It's spelled lowercase D-E-S, no space, capital J-A-R-D-I-N-S. The intent of the 5% rule was to stop works with negligible support from getting on the ballot when there were very few works with substantial support. However, now that there's been a renaissance of short fiction, there are literally dozens of Hugo-worthy works being published in many different venues. And it's becoming more and more difficult for any one of them to cross the 5% threshold, because not everyone reads the same works, not everyone even reads the same recommended reading lists, and Hugo voters, in general, have a laudable reluctance to coordinate their nominations. So we have a paradoxical system that's responding to an increase in the number of Hugo-worthy works by reducing the number of slots they get on the final ballot. The 5% rule, it was well-intentioned, it's had a good run, we've seen how it works, and we found that it makes more problems than it solved. It's time to abolish it.
A speech against adoption, Mr. Yellow.
Still Ben Yellow. I'd like to provide a somewhat of a correction to what was stated as the intent of the rule being the maker of the initial motion for the 5% rule. The feeling was not that there wasn't a great deal of worthy work. The feeling was that if you couldn't make 5% of the ballots, what you're looking at is noise, not signal. Square root of n is not your friend when you're looking at a tiny number of ballots. And what that means is that the work that is in fifth place and the work that is in sixth place and the work that is in fourth place are effectively all getting the same number of votes, and therefore let's throw out the long tail. It is possible that that is no longer meaningful, but the purpose is not to eliminate works, it's to try and separate signal from noise.
A speech in favor, yes.
Still Joshua Kronigold. Before I was a Neo, the year I shan't debate, we made a rule for our premier award. Even if it made the cut, nomination met its fate. If 1 in 20 didn't think it scored. At first it seemed a good rule, avoided the long tails. But later when the field ballooned in size, if our population fails to all read the same tales, where the ballot's concerned, there's too much for the prize. Then yes, the genre was small. Now, though, you can't read it all. Then tastes were more concentrated, the best stories rated, for the Hugos were slated. We must this rule amend. At this point, it's hard to defend. I think that it makes no sense to drop works that lack 5%. Thank you.
In favor. The chair...
Those lyrics, please.
The chair, yes. However, the chair classifies the member's previous speech as a funny once, and the members are advised to take that as it may. A speech against the adoption? You have an amendment. That would be okay. Dr. Lurie?
Given our earlier discussion about whether or not Hugo administrators could publish the results of candidates receiving fewer than 4-5 votes, I would move to amend the proposal to strike out, but not including any candidate receiving fewer than 5 votes.
In the second half of the amendment, section 3.11.4, the last few words of the existing 3.11.4 are, but not including any candidate receiving, I'm sorry, is that what you were asking?
Yes. So yeah,
the last few words, all the rest of the sentence, correct?
Right. What it says is that The Hugo Committee shall make public within 90 days after the Worldcon the nominating voting totals in each category for the top 15 vote getters, but not including any candidate receiving fewer than five works. I would just strike the "but not including any candidate receiving fewer than five works."
The chair rules the amendment not germane to the subject of the original amendment. The original amendment is on taking up the issues of 5%. This exceeds the scope of the original proposal and is primarily in there to show the context. You can introduce it next year as a new idea if you wish. All right. We're looking then for a speech against the proposal. Any speech? All right. Mr. Jardin is appealing the ruling of the chair that the amendment to strike out the last few words of 311.4 is not germane. Is there a second to the appeal?
Second.
Very well. How much time total remains in debate?
134 seconds.
Let's make that 130 seconds divided in half. That will.
Divided in half, you mean split equally between the times, not half of that for the discussion on the appeal?
No. The appeal in favor of the chair and opposed to the chair, half and half of that 130
okay.
seconds.
That's what it will be anyway.
The chair believes that, and this is not the first time this has happened, we show the context of amendments, but the actual scope of the amendment proposed to the body was to deal with the 5% rule. We are going afield from that, further afield than we need to in a proposal. It is a different subject entirely to deal with the fewer than five votes in this case. And that's the chair's ruling on that. A speech against the ruling of the chair, Dr. Leary.
While I agree somewhat with what the chair has just said, it seems to me that if you eliminate the 5% rule, you are far more likely to see candidates that receive fewer than five votes in the top 15 nominees. And therefore, I think it is relevant because it is a direct result of the effect of the other part of the proposal.
Speech in favor of the ruling of the chair. I'm trying to think who hasn't had an opportunity. Well, Mr. Yallo was the first one who stood up. Mr. Yallo.
In any question of germaneness. In any question of germaneness, it has to be germane to what the initial motion is doing. The initial motion is only touching the 5% rule, and anything outside the 5% rule would not therefore be germane.
Okay, a speech. Question of privilege. The member will come to the microphone, state your name, state the question.
My name is Terry Neal, and my point of privilege is that there are several people in this room who cannot pop to their feet as fast as Mr. Yallo. And I would request that you take that into consideration when you are choosing who to speak. Thank you.
The chair will attempt to bear that in mind. Speech against the chair, Mr. Desjardins.
There was a ruling the other day that this was a minimum, that this was intended to be, this was not in, sorry. This was not the, but not including any candidate receiving fewer than five votes. It was not intended to be a restriction. This was a minimum that they were required to publish, not a maximum. And I'm afraid that by deleting the text, it will change the interpretation. And so, it was not our intent to change that interpretation of the
time for debate opposing the chair's ruling has expired. How much time remains in favor?
15 seconds.
The chair would like to use the rest of it. Okay. The question of germaneness is a matter of scope. It would be no more in, the chair believes it would be no more in favor in scope to strike the last few words of it than to go ahead and to strike out 90 and insert 180. On the question of the germaneness of this motion, those who believe that the those who believe the chair's ruling is correct and that the amendment to strike the last few words of 311.4 is not germane and therefore not in order. Those who believe the chair's ruling is correct, raise your hands. Hands down. Those opposing the chair's ruling, hands down. There being less than the majority in the negative, the chair's ruling is sustained. The amendment is not germane. Debate, I do believe that all debate for this proposal has expired.
Yeah,
is there a motion to extend debate? No, I'm asking Mr. Kronengold, who's rose. Yes, in fact, he can make a motion to amend. It would be undebatable. Mr. Kronengold, come to the microphone to state your amendment.
I move to amend modifying 3.11.4, inserting the word non-finalist before candidate in, but not including any candidate receiving fewer than 5 votes. So it would now read, but not including any non-finalist candidate receiving fewer than 5 votes.
The chair also rules the amendment not germane. Does anyone want to try to appeal that? It's an undebatable appeal. All those in favor of the chair's ruling that the amendment is not germane, raise your hands. Hands down. Those opposed, raise your hands. Hands down. The chair's ruling is sustained. The amendment is not germane. Mr. Glazer. That would be 1 minute each side, correct? Is there any, is there a motion, sorry, is there a second?
Mr. Chair, point of personal privilege.
What is the question? Come to the speaker. I restated the short amendment, but what's the question of privilege?
My name is Terry Neal, and you are still talking too fast for the translators.
I'll try. It has been moved and seconded to extend the debate by 2 minutes, which of course would be evenly divided. A two-thirds vote being necessary to extend debate. All those in favor of extending the day, raise your hands. Hands down. Those opposed, there being less than 10 hands down, debate is not extended. The question is, I'm trying to get moving. The question is on the adoption of B.1.2, the 5% solution, as printed. A majority being necessary to adopt this and send it on to next year's Worldcon. All those in favor, raise your hands. Hands down. Those opposed, hands down. The affirmative has it. The motion is adopted and is sent on to next year's Worldcon for ratification. Next is, B15, multiple nominations. Question of privilege. Member will state their question of privilege.
My name is Kate Secor, and I was wondering if it would be possible.
Microphone, thank you.
I was wondering if it would be possible to add the page numbers on the slides next to the things that are up for debate.
Yes, the answer is yes.
The answer is yes. The parliamentarian will do what they can. The head table is getting caught up. Where'd it go? It's next is multiple nominations, item B.B15. Oh, I see what happened. It starts on page 22. That's what threw me off. All right. Are you ready? Item B15, multiple nominations. Moved to amend the WSFS Constitution to eliminate the possibility of a work simultaneously appearing on the final ballot in multiple categories by adding words as follows. Insert the following section after section 3.2.8. No work shall appear in more than one category on the final award ballot. 2. Insert the following section after existing section 3.8.6. If a work is eligible in more than one category, and if the work receives sufficient nominations to appear in more than one category, the Worldcon committee shall determine in which category the work shall appear after consulting with the author of the work, insofar as it is possible to do so under the provisions of Section 3.9. Which of the makers of this motion wants preference in speaking? The chair recognizes Mr. Dashoff. The younger, yes. Wait, sorry. This has 6 minutes debate time.
Jared Dashoff, or Mr. I guess I'm the younger, sure.
Hold the mic.
Swallow the
mic. Hold it. Yeah, there you go.
I'm too tall for this mic stand. We proposed this amendment mostly out of the other motion that we have proposed, which is the best series, but it has some applicability elsewhere, and it is mostly concerned with making sure that in the potential world where there is a best series, that a book which is eligible in both series and novel cannot be in both, and it would also apply to a potential YA Hugo should one become into existence. And I would like to note that this is generally done in other categories where the Hugo administrator moves things based on the creator of the work.
For what will the member yield for a question?
Yes.
Remember, it's using up your debate time.
My name is Kate Secor, and I would like to ask, if a work of original fiction is published on a podcast, and that podcast is then nominated in Best Fancast, does that prevent the story from appearing in the story categories as a subset of the podcast that was nominated?
As a not Hugo administrator, because I'm not insane, I don't know if I can answer that. My gut reaction would be no, the work of original fiction is a different work from the podcast, because they are different categories rather than two written fiction works, like a YA work and a novel work. But I can't speak to that definitively. That would be a better question for someone who has been a past or future Hugo administrator.
An excellent answer.
Speech against. Have you relinquished the floor, Mr. Dashoff? Yeah. In that case, it's too late.
I think putting the mic in the stand.
Yeah, that's right. Speech against. Mr. Lorenz.
My name is John Lorenz. As Mr. Dashoff the Younger has stated, that much of this is the existing practice of the Hugo administrators. However, what we have nominally done over the years is if something is eligible in two categories, the usual practice is to place it in the category with the most votes that it receives. The problem I have with this amendment is the last line, after consulting with the author insofar as it is possible to do so. We closed votes on March 10th this year, announced them on April 4th. We did not have the ballot finalized until April 2nd. If we're in a situation where something qualifies in both categories and we're waiting to able to contact the author before we make decisions, and authors live all over the world now and sometimes hard to track down right away, that means we don't know who is going to be eligible if the author decides it's going to be in category A or B, who the next person is that's in that category that would move up, and we wouldn't be able to contact them to find out if they were agreed to it. So this really puts a real time crunch on the Hugo administration, which is already time crunched. I have no problems with the general idea of this. However, I think that requiring us to get contact the author before making the decision could cause us real problems.
Yes, over here. Yes, Ms. Neal. This is in favor of the proposal, correct?
Yeah. Yes, that's correct. My name is Terry Neal, and in response to the previous speaker, I point out that the language of this amendment says that the Worldcon committee shall determine, in consultation with the author, insofar as it is possible to do.
Let's see now. Yes, against is... I'm gonna ask. No, Dave. I'm gonna call upon you as a Hugo administrator. Okay. Yes. If you want it. He did stand up. He just gave it away.
I'm moving to amend the substitute.
To amend?
Yes.
Okay. You're gonna remove an amendment.
Backstage, do it for me.
Mr. McCarty.
My name is Dave McCarty. I move to amend the current proposal to drop trying to contact the speaker and instead replace that with it shall be moved into the category in which it gets the most nominations and choose, and that way we are supporting the will of the voters, of the nominators.
I'm working on exact wording of what the member has moved.
That's good. I only roughly have it.
I believe you are moving to amend this so that it would read, if a work is eligible in more than one category, and if the work receives sufficient nominations to appear in more than one category, the Worldcon committee shall determine in which category the work shall appear based on... Hear me out. Don't try and read... Up to that point. Based on the category in which it receives the most nominations.
That is substantially what I think, yes. I agree with that wording.
That would strike out the words, after consulting with the author of the work, insofar as it is possible to do so under the provisions of Section 3.9, and insert, what did I just say? You're not helping.
Based on the category.
In which it receives the most nominations. That's why there's a secretary here. Thank you. I appreciate your help. I really do, okay? Is there a second to Mr. McCarty's amendment? Second. Mr. McCarty, first of all, how much
time? There are 114 seconds total remaining in debate.
Okay, let's make it 120 seconds, so 1 minute each way in favor and opposed to the amendment.
I believe there's a question.
You want to yield? It's using your time to speak in favor of it.
I will yield for a question.
The member will come forward and give the question.
And this fills out bingo cards from yesterday.
Helen Montgomery, my question would be either for you or for Mr. Lorenz. As the process stands right now, you guys have to contact potential nominees anyway in order to get their acceptance. Why would this make it any different?
The question is, okay, you're doing it to Mr. McCarty, yeah, because Mr. McCarty has the floor.
I can competently answer the question. The reason that this changes the process is this means that we can't move on and contact the next nominee until we've heard back from the author, which can take up to the day before we have to nominate the ballot. It can cause a crunch.
Another question. You yield for another question?
One more question.
Harry and Lori, I'll try to make this quick. So if an author were nominated in two categories, say YA and Best Novel, and they got more nominations in YA, would you tell them they were also eligible in Best Novel so they could withdraw the YA? Or would they not know that they could have been in the other category?
That is under the judgment of the administrator, so I could say how I would do it, but I don't believe that my answer would be consistent upon how every administrator would do it, so I don't think my answer would be meaningful.
Mr. McCarty, would you like to speak actually in favor of your own amendment?
Yes. Have 7 seconds to do so.
Would there be objection to giving him 30 seconds? You have 30 seconds.
All right. So the concern that John and I have is that it's difficult and to contact everybody in a timely manner and get the ballot nailed down. And until you're trying to do it in the hours that you have, It's a lot more difficult than you imagine. Having to wait on an answer back from somebody before we know what to do with the next nomination causes significant problems, especially in cases where the one trails to the next, trails to the next. So giving the administrator definitive direction on do this in the manner that we actually do it anyway would be a good thing.
Time has expired in favor of the amendment. There's 1 minute of debate time against the amendment. Is there anyone who wishes to speak against the amendment? Ms. Secor.
I'm Kate Secor. I continue to have really grave concerns about the superset subset problem, and if we're not contacting the creators of the works to tell them that there's a problem, this is just going to make it worse, because now you've got someone who could have been a nominee, and somebody else who created the work that their work appeared in has decided that they don't get to. That seems really odd to me.
Is there anyone else who wishes to speak against the amendment? Mr. Jared Dashoff. Ms. Hildebrand.
Leanne Hildebrand, and my only concern about this is when dealing with absolute vote totals, that I can imagine a situation where a work receives a greater percentage, so has a more dominant, was liked by a greater number of percentage of people within one category than in another, but because another category has a larger number of folks who vote for it, receives more votes, and therefore was more liked in the smaller category. That's my concern about making this vote numbers. Nomination numbers, excuse me.
Time for debate has expired. On the amendment to strike out after consulting the author of the work insofar it is possible to do so under the provisions of section 3.9 and to insert the work that receives the most nominations. All those in favor of the change to the proposal, raise your hands. Hands down. Those opposed to the change, hands down. The affirmative has it. The amendment to the proposal is adopted. There is no time remaining for debate on this proposal. Now, excuse me. Come and state the amendment, which will be undebatable, unless a debate time is extended. Dr. Adams.
Andrew Adams, I believe I would like to propose amendment substitution where it says the Worldcon Committee, I believe we should say Hugo Subcommittee.
The chair rules the motion out of order. The Constitution states that the Worldcon Committee has the authority to do this and has the authority then to irrevocably delegate it to a Hugo Subcommittee. It does not have to create a Hugo Subcommittee, and they have not always done so. The motion is out of order. On the motion to adopt, on the proposal to adopt the amended 3.1.5 multiple nominations, is there anyone unclear on what the revised wording is?
Yes.
Very well. I need the Secretary's help on this. Thank you. Section 1, insert the following after section 3.2.8, which is, no work shall appear in more than one category on the final award ballot. Section 2, insert the following after existing section 3.8.6. If a work is eligible in more than one category, and if the work receives sufficient nominations to appear in more than one category, the Worldcon Committee shall determine in which category the work shall appear based on the category in which it receives the most nominations. Is there any question upon what we are voting on at this time? All those in favor of this constitutional amendment, raise your hands. Hands down. Those opposed? Hands down. Hands down. Question privilege? I am. All right. Let me take the vote again.
It's pausing between the two halves this time.
All those in favor of the constitutional amendment, raise your hands. Hands down. Those opposed to this constitutional amendment, raise your hands. Hands down. The affirmative has it. The constitutional amendment is passed and is sent on to next year's Worldcon for ratification. I think we'll have time for one more, and I believe we need to take a cartridge change. Yes? Yes. This meeting is in recess for not more than 2 minutes. Don't get up. The meeting will return to order. Item B16, nominee diversity, page 23. There's a parliamentary, okay, the member will come to the lectern and state their parliamentary inquiry.
Lisa Paddle, if we wanted to make a motion to lay it on the table until a specific time, is that permissible?
Let me finish, I'll tell her. Sorry. State the question, please.
If I wanted to make a motion to lay it on the table, not indefinitely, but until a specific time or a specific motion had been considered first, is this permissible?
The question the member is trying to make, the motion the member is trying to make is to postpone to a certain time. You wish to postpone this to some other part of the agenda?
Yes, until after EPH has been considered, because that changes the nature.
Is the member moving to postpone consideration of item B16,
yes,
nominee diversity? Let me finish stating it before you say so. Is the member moving to postpone consideration of nominee diversity until after the consideration of E Pluribus Hugo?
Yes.
Is there a second to the member's motion? A majority being necessary. Those in favor of postponing this motion until after the consideration of E Pluribus Hugo, raise your hands. Hands down, those opposed. Hands down, the affirmative appears to have it. The affirmative has it, and nominee diversity, item B16, is moved to after the consideration of E Pluribus Hugo. Yes, Ms. Secor? Come to the microphone. Nobody's going to hear you.
This is Kate Secor. Point of personal privilege, I'd like to point out that that means we're probably not going to get to it.
That was debate on the postponement, honestly. That, it doesn't matter. The chair needs to make an observation here to members. For what it's worth, we have actually completed all of the things that our rules require us to do. From this point forward in this meeting, the motion to adjourn sine die, to close the session entirely without even considering any of the further items in the agenda, adoptable by a majority vote, is in order. And any proposal on the agenda that has not been considered when we adjourn sine die dies. Is that clear?
Yes.
Very well. For what purpose does the member rise? I'm trying to figure out what the member is making. Would the member come to the microphone and state his motion so I can try and figure out what he's trying to do?
It's not the committee, it's the business.
I know what he's saying.
I move that we close this. Nick Thomas Monahan. I move that we close this business meeting since, as you said, all necessary motions and.
Is the member moving to adjourn sine die?
Yes.
Very well. Sine die is a parliamentary term meaning without date. It would close the Worldcon business meeting, it would end this meeting, it would end tomorrow's meeting, it would kill any proposals that are left on the agenda. This is a debatable motion. Is there a second to the member's motion? Would the member like to debate his motion? This is the chair, 5 minutes, I believe, is because of amendments. Would the member like to debate his motion?
Thomas Monahan, the reason I wish to end this meeting is we have covered everything needed and some of the motions, resolutions in the future are rushed and unorganized, and it would just extend indefinitely from what I've heard and what I think will happen. And thank you very much.
A speech against? I'm trying to pick somebody who hasn't had much of an opportunity. Yeah. How about, yes? I haven't called on this side of the room much. In the back. Yes, you.
Pablo.
Ooh, the parliamentarian has advised me of something I really hadn't thought of, because when we scheduled items specifically at the preliminary business meeting, we made them, although we didn't actually use that word, we made them general orders. And that, and we have to discharge all general orders before we can adjourn. Wow. I believe the parliamentarian is raising a point of order that the motion to adjourn sine die is not actually in order at this time. The chair slaps himself on the wrist and rules the motion to adjourn sine die is not in order at this time. Ms. Hayes, would you come to the microphone and speak?
I would like to move to adjourn until tomorrow's meeting, as we are on a very tight time schedule today, and I would like to have a life.
There is a second to the motion. I would like to ask the members if we may momentarily set that motion on the table. I have a request that I'd forgotten about earlier here that I really want to take up. Thank you. Is there any objection? Please give the chair some. Okay. It is
11:48.
Okay. I've had several people come to me with variations of this motion. The chair would like to ask unanimous consent that when we adjourn the final business meeting, that we adjourn in memory of Bobby Dufault and Peggy Ray Sapienza. Is there any objection to this motion? They're hearing none. When we adjourn tomorrow, we will adjourn in memory of Bobby Dufault and Peggy Ray Sapienza. The chair does remind members that the CART system is not an official record of this meeting. It's Dufault is D-U-F-A-U-L-T, like Dufault.
Right.
Yes. Like Dufault, not default. And yes, that's right. It's D-U capital F, all right. But again, that is not an official record of the meeting. And again, before I take up Ms. Hayes's motion, the chair would like to express his a great appreciation to our interpreters, both the sign language and CART, for the very hard job they have. Particularly because we use technical terms that they are not necessarily familiar with. And we ask, and we thank you for putting up with us. On the motion to adjourn, is there any debate on this? I hope not. A parliamentary inquiry. Would the member come to the microphone and state his parliamentary inquiry, please?
Todd Dashoff, could I just have a confirmation from the chair that this means we will pick up tomorrow where we are leaving off right now?
Yes.
Thank you.
When we come back, we will pick up with, the next one would be best series. It would, of course...
Nominee diversity.
We postponed diversity to follow EPH, relative to EPH. It would, of course, be in order at the time we come up tomorrow. The next item on the agenda is going to be best series. That's where we are. It would be in order at that time to suspend the rules and take up something out of its proper order. The general orders are not special orders. They can be taken up earlier as well as later. All right. Is there any objection to adjourning at this time? Yes, there's an objection. Are you wanting to debate this? Take the wireless microphone to him, if you would, please. This is a accessibility issue, please. On the motion to adjourn, this is a speech against adjourning. The motion to adjourn is maybe always in order, but made in this form, it was debatable.
Michael Stern, and this is actually a parliamentary inquiry.
This member will state his parliamentary inquiry.
Yes, doesn't the word adjourn mean finish the meeting? This should be a recess.
No.
I would have thought after this many days, y'all would have figured this out. Adjourn, in this sense, means to adjourn each day's meeting or each individual meeting. To close the entire series of Worldcon meetings is to adjourn, and the technical term is sine die, S-I-N-E-D-I-E, sine die, meaning without date. The motion to adjourn sine die is in order once all of the general orders have been discharged. We adjourn each day. The recesses are what we hold as the short breaks within a current meeting. Is this clear?
Yes.
Is there any objection to adjourning at this time?
Yes.
There are objections. All those in favor? A parliamentary inquiry. This member will come to the microphone and state their parliamentary inquiry. The chair was not actually intending to hold a parliamentary rules seminar.
Bill Taylor, the chair made a ruling earlier, just a few moments ago, that the motion to adjourn CDA was out of order because of general orders pending. The chair has just stated that a motion to adjourn is always in order. Which would have left a general order hanging. My question is then, which is it?
Yeah. There is a book called Time Enough for Love. Some of you may have heard of it. It's by an author that some of you have possibly read, known as Robert Heinlein. The character, Lazarus Long, is in this book. And there are excerpts from the notebooks of Lazarus Long in Time Enough for Love, which includes the motion to adjourn is always in order, as a colloquialism. In an incredibly technical sense, it's not true. The chair was attempting to be jocular, but obviously failed entirely. On the motion to adjourn, all those in favor of adjourning, raise your hands. Hands down. Those opposed, raise your hands. The affirmative has it. We are adjourned until 10 o'clock tomorrow morning.